Hi everyone, my name is Vasudha. Welcome to my channel. In today's video, I have picked 5 of my favorite self-help books. Now, self-help is a very big, very wide topic. It can cover leadership roles, it can cover how to change your habits, how to improve your communication skills, and so on. The books that I have chosen talk about improving our personal and interpersonal relationships. So let's dive in. I'll start with a book which I read most recently. It's by one of my favorite self-help authors, Mitch Albom, and the book is called Finding Chica. And the subtitle goes like A Girl, An Earthquake, and the Making of a Family. Now, this book was published in 2019 and it's not a very long book, somewhere around 250 pages. But I listened to the audio version of the book and I would suggest you all also listen to the book because it has actual voice clippings of the little girl Chica and Mitch Albom and his wife, and that adds a lot of charm and character to the whole book. The book is a memoir or an autobiography, if you can say, partly. It's actually based on a true story. And the reason I have chosen this book in the self-help category then is because the author discusses about the fragility of life, the uncertainty of life, the unpredictability of life in this book. He talks about the meaning of life, how temporary life is, and how much we take life for granted, and sometimes how, with the presence of just one individual, how the meaning of our life completely changes. The central character of this book is a little girl called Chica. She's 6 years old and she loses her life due to a serious disease, and I'm not bringing out any spoilers here because it's evident from the title. And right from the beginning of the book, the author talks about this little girl and her disease. So there comes the temporariness of life, there comes the whole understanding about and the value of life for us, and especially losing someone so close to you at a little age is what the author brings out so beautifully. The book is written in a completely eloquent manner. It's very touching story, and the book is written in hindsight. And if you have read Mitch Albom's earlier book Tuesdays with Maury, there also you will know that he talks about his relationship with his professor who is on a deathbed in hospital. And Mitch Albom himself says in this book, Finding Chica, that it's one thing to lose an elderly person, but it's a completely different experience of losing someone so young. And there comes the fragility of life and how life is so unpredictable, and losing a small child is simply incomprehensible. And how in the first place Mitch Albom found Chica in his life is something very interesting and also very hard-hitting. This book is not an easy read, to be honest. It's an emotional roller coaster ride, and it's not for the faint-hearted, I would say. Another extremely touching relationship that we'll find in this book is between Mitch Albom and his wife. Now, Mitch Albom has himself admitted in the book that he did not want to have children. in a way he kind of denied his wife to have their own children for the fear that his career may slow down. And even though he has candidly admitted this, confessed this in the book, I have more respect for his wife. I mean, just put yourself in that situation, in her shoes, and think how hard it must have been for her to accept that they cannot have children of their own. So denying her the right to have their own kids and living with this fact and not leaving her husband is what I think is true love. Because if it was someone else, they could have probably left their husbands and they could have married someone else for starting their own family. But his wife continued to remain in that marriage and she never probably complained. At least Mitch Albom never mentions her complaining about this. And I thought that depriving her of a child was something very painful. If you see, it was not a mutual decision. She wanted to have kids, but Mitch Albom was never ready. He never committed to having kids. So I feel that his wife is so resilient and full of love, and her character really stood out for me. And even the character of Chika herself, I mean, that little girl, she has to undergo so many treatments and MRI scans and travel from one part of the world to the other for her medical treatments. But she doesn't see her situation as tragic. She doesn't compare herself with other kids. She just seemed to enjoy the company of Mitch Albom and his wife, and she just seemed to be excited and just a bundle of joy, like all kids are. And her resilience is something which is so admirable, that how she is so full of life despite knowing that she is sick. I mean, her character is just extraordinary, and I'm so glad that Mitch Albom wrote a book on her. And whether Chika found Mitch Albom or Mitch Albom found himself is a question worth pondering, because in this book Mitch Albom himself says that he discovered so many new traits of his personality. He finally learned that he did love children. He discovered that he was very comfortable around children, and to deny that privilege or right to his wife was extremely wrong, and that was a decision that he regrets. So it's not an easy read, I would say. I mean, it's emotionally heavy. This book is really heavy, but it does bring out the message about love, relationships with our own self, with our family members, how sometimes a stranger can completely show us a new direction, a new part of ourselves that was hidden in our lives for so long. And do keep a box of tissues with you when you are reading this book. My second book is by Mark Manson. It's called The Subtle Art of Not Giving an F. This book also has around 200 pages. The language is very light, it's casual, as the title also suggests, but the book is quite meaningful. And in this book, he says that life itself is a form of suffering, and pain and suffering are an integral part of our life. In fact, through pain, through suffering, our life gets meaning. Mark Manson says that the purpose of our life has become to chase happiness, to eliminate all the negatives, to eliminate pain, or to minimize our sufferings. Now, he says that happiness is not a solvable equation. And there is no such thing like a life without problems. Rather than hoping for a life with no problems, he says that we should hope for a life with good problems. Those kind of problems which help us learn more about ourselves and help us grow. So according to him, to have a constant aim of chasing happiness is actually an antidote to self-help. It's an antidote to happiness, and it's a disservice to our own self. He says that allow yourself to feel low and to experience the negative experiences. It's very important for us to sometimes go down in the pit, basically to experience emotions in a more authentic way, and not to constantly sugarcoat our emotions, not to constantly live in a delusion that we will be fine and everything will be okay. I'm not using the F word here, but let's replace F with attention. So he says that we give too much attention to too many people and to too many things, which we don't have to. He says that we must give attention to people who matter in our lives, but not to everything they do or say. So he gives the example of our partners and spouses. He says that we must understand that our partners matter a lot to us, but not everything that they will say or do should affect us. So he says that you need to understand that you have limited F's, or in other words, you can only give so much attention to the people around you or to the things around you. So don't overburden yourselves with too many expectations and to please everybody around you. You need to live your life in a more authentic way. As much as I enjoyed reading this book, I really liked this book a lot, but I did not enjoy reading his other book, Everything is F'd. So that did not click with me, but The Subtle Art was really interesting and I found a lot of wisdom from that book. The third self-help book is Ikigai, The Japanese Secret to a Long and Happy Life by Hector Garcia. Ikigai in Japanese means finding the true reason, the purpose or meaning of your life. And this book brings about the secrets of a happy and a long life from the land of the longest living people in the world, that is Japan. The book talks about mostly ancient wisdom or the conventional practices that the Japanese have been following for centuries, perhaps even millennia, and some of the key secrets of their long and happy life include a well-balanced diet, like the whole rainbow diet that we know of today was something which the Japanese have been practicing for many years. How many types of fruits they consume in a day, and even they swear by jasmine tea. And the book explains the benefits of the jasmine tea, the properties it has, and so on and so forth. And it's a very, very well researched book. It provides a lot of information on the Japanese diet and the other key secrets of their happy and long life, which includes sleep, which includes body movement, which includes their Zen philosophy of not worrying so much. They even have a Japanese word for this, and even continuing our passions till the very end, to take life slowly or to reconnect with nature. So these are some of the main elements of a Japanese life, and how these small but significant habits help us to remain healthy and also improves the longevity of our lives. So the book explains each of these secrets, or actually rules, in great length, and there is a lot to learn from this book. In one experience, the author talks about attending a birthday party in Okinawa. Okinawa is an island where most of the centenarians of the world live. And the youngest member of that birthday party was 83 years old. And the person whose birthday they were celebrating had turned 99. So what is the secret of these people who live for well over 100 years? The longest living person was around 117 years, coming from Japan. So this book is all about learning to live a healthy, happy life, and that would eventually increase the longevity of our life as well, and finding the true purpose of our life, finding our ikigai, as they call it. My next book is by Lucy Danziger and Catherine Bernhoff, and it's called The 9 Rooms of Happiness. Now this is a book of our psychology, of emotions, and it's a women-centered book, if I can say. The authors have extremely interestingly categorized the most important issues of our lives into different rooms of a house, and I really like this metaphor. For example, they talk about how a living room equals to our place where we develop our friendships and our social life. Or for example, our bathroom is a place where we develop our relationship with our own bodies and issues of our body image and how we perceive ourselves physically are dealt with. Or for example, how a basement signifies childhood memories and the bedroom signifies our intimate relations with our partners, and so on. This book offers real case studies of emotional, mental, psychological challenges that women face on a day-to-day basis in their interpersonal relationships, whether it's with their husbands or their siblings or their parents, their boss, or even with their friends. And the authors have carefully selected those case studies to cover a range of these issues and relationships. And the authors offer completely unconventional advice. They ask us to look at the room where we are standing, or what room could be responsible for our emotional issues or emotional mess. For example, if someone is having strained intimate relations with their partners, so is it really an issue of the bedroom, or is it something to do with the kitchen area where the division of work takes place? So if a woman is heavily burdened with household responsibilities, and if the division of work is unbalanced, it could have an impact on the intimate relationships or in the bedroom, so to say. So trace the root of your problem by looking at the rooms of your life. And this I found was an extremely original and extremely creative way of dealing with our emotional challenges. The book provides a neat categorization of 8 rooms, but the 9th room, they say, can be left messy. In fact, they say that if there is a room in your house or in your emotional house which is messy, don't let that affect your all other rooms. Don't let it have an impact on the other areas of your life. It's okay to be in a mess in some area of your life. So the biggest takeaway for me from this book was that it's okay to be imperfect, and don't let dissatisfaction in one area of your life spill over to the other areas of your life, and don't emotionally abuse yourself for getting everything in control or in order or getting everything right. And the last book here is Happier at Home by Gretchen Rubin. This book is about what to prioritize and how to organize our home life and the most important issues related to our home life, like our children, our siblings, our husband, our parents, and so on. And the way she does this is by picking up one theme for herself for every month, starting from September to May, which is the school year in the US. So for each month of the year, she picks up a theme which is related to her own personal challenges, whether it is about her marriage or parenthood or neighborhood or her own body issues, and what changes she would like to bring in those areas of her life and how she would like to improve them, what kinds of things she would like to do less of, and what kind of things she would like to do more of in order to make her life more livable, more joyful and happier. And for that, she adds some resolutions in each of those areas of her life. She makes sure that she follows them, and some of them are very simple, but yet they have a deep and profound and long-lasting impact on not just her own self, but even for the people around her, her own family members, like kissing her daughters goodbye before dropping them to school. Now, these are very small changes, but that's how we create an atmosphere of a happy home. And what I really liked about the author was that she is so transparent and honest about her weaknesses, because in order for us to bring changes in our lives, we first have to admit that things are going wrong. We first have to accept that we do have some shortcomings, and the author does it so candidly, and write a book about that is really brave of her. And she takes all her shortcomings in her stride. She says that this is self-knowledge. I am building self-awareness, and I need to know myself more in a very objective manner. So if you are planning to organize your home life, if there are certain sticky points in your home life, then you can definitely take some good leads from this book. So those were some of my favorite self-help books. It's a genre I really like reading about. If you like this video, please give it a thumbs up and subscribe to my channel, and do share your recommendations, your favorite self-help books as well. Until next video, thank you and bye.